up watching Fiddler on the Roof. To this day, it's one of my favorite musicals, though my kids absolutely hate it. I don't care. But when I was with our creative team and we were planning this particular Sunday and we were just throwing ideas up on the whiteboard, this was my very first submission. In fact, I love it so much, I just broke out in song right there with our creative team. Now, before you graciously humor me for 2 minutes and 34 seconds, thank you in advance for your cooperation. I'm not going to sing it, by the way. We're just going to watch a piece of this. I just want to set up this particular scene for those of you who have maybe never received the grace of God to watch it before. Tevye is a poor Jewish milkman in a poor Jewish village called Anatevka. The year is 1905, and this little village is being oppressed by an ever-growing imperial Russia. And things are getting hard for this little village. Things are getting hard for Tevye and his family because his five daughters are beginning to grow up and get married, and that's creating stress. There's trouble in the town. And you compound this with just his ever-growing devotion to Yahweh, but he sees himself as just this poor milkman. What could he know? What could he do? And his daughter, Hodel, comes to him and she says that she does not want to get married out of obligation and arrangement, which was the tradition of the day, but she wants to get married for love, which they call the new style. And so out of that, Tevye talks to his wife, Golda, and he wants to find out, do you actually love me? Like, do you really love me? And their conversation is captured in this song. Give your attention to the screens.
Do you love me?
Do I what?
Do you love me?
Do I love you?
Well,
with our daughters getting married and this trouble in the town, you're upset, you're worn out. Go inside, go lie down. Maybe it's indigestion.
No, Golda, I'm asking you a question. Do you love me?
You're a fool.
I know. But do you love me?
Do I love you?
Well,
for 25 years I've washed your clothes, cooked your meals, cleaned your house, given you children, milked your cow. After 25 years, why talk about love right now?
Golda, the first time I met you was on our wedding day. I was scared.
I was shy.
I was nervous.
So was I.
But my father and my mother said we'd learn to love each other. And now I'm asking, Golda, do you love me?
I'm your wife.
I know. But do you love me?
Do I love him?
Well?
For 25 years I've lived with him, fought with him, starved with him. 25 years my bed is his. If that's not love, what is?
Then you love me.
I suppose I do.
And I suppose I love you too. It doesn't change a thing, but even so, after 25 years, it's
that's good stuff, right? You could choose to be wrong if you want to, but I'm just saying, like, that's really good stuff. My wife and I are about to enter into our 25th year. She doesn't know this yet. Don't tell her, but I plan on us working up that duet for our kids after 25 years. How do you know someone loves you? How do you know? They show it, right? I mean, after 25 years, they show it. It's not just something we say, it's something that we live. And Jesus, in our text, he's going to combine these two things of love and action, love and obedience. And so if you have your Bibles, you can open them up or you can turn them on to John chapters 14 and 15. That's where we're going to park it for today, John 14 and 15. And because we are people of the book and we honor the word of the Lord, I'm going to ask that you would stand where you are as you're turning to that. Stand right now. We're going to look at John chapter 14. It's going to be on the screen here, verse 15. And I just want us to read this out loud together. John 14, 15. It says this. Let's read it out loud, church. If you love me, you will keep my commands. You may be seated. I'm just kidding. Don't sit down. Man, you guys are quick. Simple, right? Easy. Simple to understand. And the beauty of it is that it is quite simple, actually. If we love God, we will obey him. This is what we do. Love is this, or obedience is this evidence of love. And obedience is just kind of this natural outflowing of love. We'll talk about that in more detail here in just a second. But let's go on to our text here. Skip to verse 21 here. Just listen. Jesus said, "The one who has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. And the one who loves me will be loved by my Father. I also will love him and will reveal myself to him." Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, "Lord, how is it you're going to reveal yourself to us and not to the world?" And Jesus answered, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him and we will come to him and make our home with him. The one who doesn't love me will not keep my words. The word that you hear is not mine, but it's from the Father who sent me." This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Amen. You can have a seat now, for real. For Jesus, there is this unmistakable connection between love and obedience. And I used to think that what Jesus was getting at here was that we give evidence of our love for him through our obedience. And I do think that's part of what he's driving at. But I think it goes beyond that. I think what Jesus is also saying is that our obedience is just kind of the natural outflowing of that love. It flows out of love. And so the question we have to ask ourselves is, if I'm not obeying him, if I am disobeying Jesus, I have to ask the question, do I love him? That's kind of heavy, don't you think? Oh, I say I love him, but do I love him? Because here's the thing, obedience reveals love. Reveals is one of John's favorite words, by the way, in his gospel. We're going to use it a lot this morning. Obedience reveals love. In the last five short verses of scripture that we've read together, Jesus makes two conditional statements. If you love me, you will keep my commands. And if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. Our obedience reveals our part of that condition. What's funny is that the word that Jesus uses for love here in this text comes from the root word agape. This is an unconditional kind of love for him. This conditional response is rooted in an unconditional love. For those of you who are married, I have a question for you. How long did you know the person you married before you married them? My wife Leah and I, we were friends for 2 years before we officially began dating. And then we were a couple for 2 years before we got married. So if you do the math right, carry the one, that's four. Okay, we knew one another for 4 years before we got married. And you know, not everyone's story is like that, right? For some of you, 4 years probably seems like an eternity. I knew a couple who... they knew one another for 2 weeks before he proposed, and there was a ring on that finger, and they are still married after 40-plus years today. So it's just, I mean, everybody's story is a little bit different on this. But how long did you know the person before you married them? I would argue that compared to the commitment you were making, it's quite short, right? Because no matter how long you knew this person, you're committing your entire lifetime to them. You're committing your entire lifetime to a person you've only known for a portion of your lifetime. I think that's why Gary Chapman said there's a fine line between being in love and being insane, right? Logically, don't you think you would want to fully know someone, before you commit yourself to them? Wouldn't that be smart? It doesn't seem to always go that way. And it doesn't seem to always go that way with Jesus either. I think this is why the earliest followers of Jesus would be willing to immediately leave everything behind and follow this man that they kind of know some stuff about. It's why we saw from last Sunday in the video earlier, but Ezra was baptized last week. Here, Callie was baptized today. Where even a young child can commit their entire lifetime to Jesus. They can't know everything. I didn't know everything at 9. And yet, we can make that kind of commitment to him. We don't have to know everything to make a lifetime commitment. Andrew Murray was a Scottish missionary to South Africa. I think he would agree with this. He wrote this in his book, Abide in Christ. He said, true discipleship consists in first following and then knowing the Lord. First following, then knowing. First we commit, then we know. We commit to obeying his commands because we love him. And we show we love him by obeying his commands. It's impossible to separate these two. What God has joined together, let no man separate. For those who say they love Jesus, commitment to obeying his commands will just flow naturally out of that love. You see, our obedience reveals love. Not just our love for God, but his love for the world. And I think that's maybe what Judas, not Iscariot, was trying to get at in verse 22. He asks Jesus this question. How are you going to reveal yourself to the world? And it seems as though at first, like, Jesus ignores the question. He doesn't. Judas is probably thinking, hey, how are you going to reveal yourself to the world? Is it going to be like in a physical way? Is it going to be in a political way? Is it going to be in a geographical way? Like, how are you going to do this, Jesus? And Jesus does answer the question, just not like Judas thought he might. Jesus says that he's going to reveal himself through the spiritual house of relationship with his people. And I think that's where all this is pointing. Because if obedience reveals love, then love reveals relationship. In John 14, 23, Jesus makes a promise. He says, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him. We will come to him. We will make our home with him. And John 14 is the only place in all the New Testament where this word for home is used. And it's used twice in that one chapter. The first time is in John 14, verse 2, where Jesus says, I'm going to go make a home for you. I'm going to go make a place for you. And the second time is here in our text for today, where Jesus promises that God will make a home for us, with us, I should say. And in 14:23, the word shows that he comes to us, and the purpose is the same here, to take up residence. And residence is used to show relationship. Because you wouldn't invite somebody over to your house to stay for an extended period of time unless you had intentions of having some kind of relationship with them, right? Well, Jesus desires to make a home for us, and he desires to make his home with us, even here and now as we love and obey him. But as Jesus goes on to unpack this idea of home, he's actually going to use a different word. And we got to go to our next text to get it. It's in John 15, verses 9 through 11. Here's what he says. As the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Remain. That's it. That's the word. Remain. Remain in my love. If you keep my commands, another conditional statement, you will remain in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commands and, say it, church, remain in his love. I've told you these things so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. The word that's translated for remain is almost identical to the Greek word that's used for home, but it does not communicate the same idea in which a house in which to live. The Greek translation for home is mone. The Greek translation of the word remain or abide in your Bible maybe is meno. Mone and meno. Meno and mone. Mone, meno. Right? Easy. Mone communicates a house, a structure, a facility. Meno communicates a state of being and permanence. Jesus will make us a house. He will. And through the Holy Spirit, Jesus will bring his house to his church. But the command, the instruction here in chapter 15, is for us to permanently dwell in his love. Think about that. Jesus wants to live indefinitely in a relationship with you. And he wants to do that in the exact same way that he lives and remains indefinitely in a love relationship with the Father. To abide in Christ assumes the most intimate union possible. Permanently. It's beautiful. And you see that the deeper a relationship goes, the more trust will grow. And I believe that's where John 15 is heading. Look at verses 12 and 13. Jesus said, "This is my command. Love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down his life for his friends." Jesus is saying that the greatest demonstration of love is to lay down your life for a friend. And we might assume that what Jesus is talking about here is a willingness to die for somebody. And that's true. That's part of it. It's just not the whole thing. To lay down simply means that, to set something down. Just set it down. It's the same word that was used in Matthew 27. After Jesus was taken off the cross and he was buried in the tomb, it says, Matthew tells us that he was set down, he was laid down, placed in a new tomb. It just means to set down. Jesus' kind of love will not only be willing to die for those that we love, but as is often more difficult, his kind of love will regularly set down our own agendas for others. We will bend down. We will humble ourselves for the good of others. And if you were to pull out from John 15, from the text where we are, if you were to pull out and look at the greater context around it, you're going to find that Jesus uses this imagery of a vine. He says, "I'm the vine, you're the branches, it is in your DNA, it is in your identity to produce fruit," or we understand that as acts of obedience. He's the vine, we're the branches, and I, you know, I want to produce a lot of fruit. I want to, don't you? I'm sure you do. Going back to what Andrew Murray said in his book, Abide in Christ, he said this also, "The most heavily laden branches bow the lowest." The most heavily laden branches bow the lowest. If we're going to bear fruit, we got to lay down. This doesn't just mean that we got to be willing to die. It means that we got to be willing to live a life of sacrifice for others. I think this is where the depths of love for Jesus will take us in this relationship. And I know that because that's the same journey he went on. That's where his love took him. Love lays down. But in verse 14, Jesus introduces a word that has shaped this message more than you know. Look at verses 14 and 15. "You are my friends if you do what I command. I do not call you servants anymore because a servant doesn't know what his master is doing. I have called you friends because I've made known to you everything I've heard from my Father." This is the first time that Jesus would ever refer to his disciples as his friends. In John's gospel, a few chapters before, John 11, he talks about his friend Lazarus. A few chapters later, after Jesus had risen from the dead, Jesus is there on the shoreline of the Sea of Tiberias. He sees that his disciples are fishing again. They're not supposed to be fishing. I'm not sure they know what else to do now that Jesus has died and raised, you know. But they're there fishing, and he calls out to the from the shore. He says, "Friends, you don't have any fish, do you?" Little jab, a playful jab, you know. But not without calling out their real identity of who they are in him. During each week of this sermon series, we've seen how Jesus takes his disciples on a journey. And right here, we're seeing how Jesus is taking his followers from the identity of that of a servant to that of a friend. This is a seismic shift of identity. This is massive. Jesus uses this word for called. He calls them friends. That's not the same as to just say he named them friends, like as a nickname or something like that. Like, "I used to name you a servant, now I'm going to name you as friend." That's not what the word called means. The word called is a very forceful word. It's more like a command. The emphasis of this word is not in just what is said, but how. The emphasis of this word is the emphasis in this word. Jesus is commanding a new identity over his followers. And it's not wrong for us, you understand, to be referred to as a servant of God. That's a good thing. Even Paul in 1 Corinthians 4, verse 1, he says, "I just want to be regarded as a servant of Christ." James, the brother of Jesus, would begin his letter by saying, "James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ." Jesus would commend being a servant. He would command being a servant. But here we see that things are kind of changing somehow. Roles seem to be shifting somehow. And I just want you to put yourself there for a moment. I want you to imagine Jesus' eyes welling up with tears in almost everything he says in this upper room discourse. The night before he'd be crucified, every word matters. Some of those tears come from his overwhelming sadness, and I think some of those tears come from unrestrained joy. He looks at his disciples not just as his creation made in his image. He looks at them not just as his ragtag group of fumbling followers. He looks at them not just as his faithful servants, but he sees them as his friends. So, what makes the difference? What makes the leap? What brings the change from servant to friend? I think it's one word: trust. Because if obedience reveals love, and love reveals relationship, here we see relationship reveals trust. Because a servant doesn't know his master's plan. The reason that Jesus could command a new identity on his followers is because he had entrusted the knowledge of his plan to them. And in this new relationship, trust goes both ways, right? I mean, obviously, we trust him. He's always been trustworthy. But what's completely bonkers to me is that Jesus actually trusts his followers. Is he insane? Maybe he's just in love. Wayne talked about this on Easter Sunday a few weeks back. Matthew's gospel records that Jesus gave the Great Commission to his followers, and some of them doubted. So it seems like Jesus is okay risking his eternal plan into the hands of the doubting, the unqualified, the uneducated, the ordinary, the simple, the unexpected, the ill-equipped. You get it. It would be like me being told to play in a professional basketball game. That's dumb, right? I mean, I love basketball. I watched it as a kid. I played it as a kid. I've watched lots of professional games in my lifetime. I've been a professional basketball game. But me, play with the pros? You're nuts. But if the coach trust that this is the only way for me to learn and to grow, I think I need to trust the coach, no matter how crazy it seems. Jesus is entrusting his followers with the calling to revolutionize the world with his limitless love, even though we can be so unlovely. Jesus is calling his followers to reveal the holiness of God, even though he knows we can be so unholy. Jesus entrusts his followers with the calling to serve as he served, even though he knows that we can be so selfish with our time and possessions. Jesus is entrusting his followers with the call to make disciple makers, even though he knows that we can be so timid and spiritually nearsighted. You know, sometimes I don't feel very trustworthy. And it's not because I'm deceptive. It's just because I'm broken. I'm busted. There's still sin in here that gets in the way of that. I don't know why Jesus would entrust his plan with me, but he has. I don't know why Jesus would entrust his plan with you, but he has. I love you. I think you're great, but, you know, come on. Jesus trusts his followers. He gave them the ability to know him, but that knowledge began with their commitment to him. Look, there's this undeserved blessing that we get to be called a friend of the Most High. But is that the end of it? Is that all there is? Is his purpose simply that we slap on a new name tag that says, "Hello, my name is Friend"? No. There's something in our text that brings us all the way back to the beginning, and it starts in verse 16. John 15, verse 16, Jesus begins like this: "You did not choose me, but I chose you." Would you permit me to use my glorified imagination for a second? I imagine that the disciples, the 12 with Jesus there, had a little moment of flashback when they heard Jesus say that. "You did not choose me, but I chose you." I wonder if Peter's going, "I remember that day." Yeah, I'll never forget that day, man. Kind of a rough night, actually. I didn't catch anything, you know. I'm a fisherman. It's what I do. I fish. But not that night. I didn't get anything. We were back on the shore. It was morning time. We're cleaning the nets, you know. Nothing to clean except the net. And I see Jesus over there up to the side. He's teaching a crowd. I'd seen him before. I'd heard him a couple times. But shortly, when I made eye contact there, he's like, hey, can I use your boat? Can we go out on the water and I can teach this group here? And I was like, I haven't had much luck with it. It's yours, you know. So we get in the boat and we push out a little ways. And he teaches the people. I'm right there. You know, I'm listening. It's good. I mean, actually, it's great. And he's done. He wraps up and he looks at me and he says, hey, let's push out a little deeper for a catch. I was like, Rabbi, you stay in your lane. I'm going to stay in mine. And I don't know, something in his face. I don't know. I said, okay, you said so. I'm going to do it. So we go out there to do the one thing I couldn't do all night. You know what I'm saying? And I cast my net and I couldn't do it. I mean, the one thing I couldn't do all night, here I am again. He commands me to do it. Do the one thing I can't do. I can't lift this thing out of the water. It's so full. I've never seen anything like this before. I panicked. I called out to Zebedee's boys. I was like, get over here. Help me out. They do. They come over. They pull it out. I've never seen so many fish in all my life. They're ecstatic. I don't know what to do. I just find myself at his feet on my knees, and I'm crying out. I'm like, I don't even deserve this. I don't even know what's going on, but I don't deserve this. You better go. And he pulls my face up, eyeball to eyeball, and he looks at me like he knew I was going to say that. And then he tells me to do something. He tells me to do the one thing I can't do. He tells me to fish for people. Yeah, I'll never forget that day, man. I wonder if that was a flashback. Jesus goes on. He said, you did not choose me, but I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce fruit. And that your fruit should, there it is again, remain. So that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. Like, I've got to ask a question in all this. Who's in charge? Who's in charge of this whole process? Well, it's Jesus. He commands our new identity as his friends, and then he's the one who determines our purpose to produce fruit, to obey. Because if obedience reveals love, and love reveals relationship, and relationship reveals trust, then trust produces obedience. So we've kind of come full circle here, right? We've kind of come all the way around. I want you to see this little clip. Maybe this can illustrate it for you. Obedience reveals love. Love reveals relationship. Relationship reveals trust. And trust produces obedience. Do you see the circle? Okay. Jessica made this for me. I can't do that kind of stuff. So I was grateful for the help here. Look, this is more than just like a convenient illustration. I think this represents a deep and rich truth. Because Jesus entrusts us with his mission, we grow in obedience, which reveals a greater love, which reveals a closer relationship, which reveals a trust, and so on and so on, and it gets richer and richer and deeper and deeper, and this is what a life of growing in the Lord as his friend looks like. And the result of this ever-deepening relationship with Jesus results in something quite beautiful and quite simple. You ready for it? Love. More love. Jesus is going to button it down real tight for us in our text. Verse 17. This is what I command you. Love one another. So, fellow friends, here's kind of what I came here to say. Friendship with Jesus is revealed in how he trusts his people to love others the way he's loved us. Friendship with Jesus is revealed. Again, that's one of John's favorite words. Is revealed in how he trusts his people to love others the way he has loved us. Do you? Do we love other people the way that Jesus has loved us? Maybe a way to think about it is, do you struggle to love anyone? Who comes to mind? I imagine they come pretty quick. Do we realize that Jesus has trusted us with this mission because he loves us? Let's be honest. This seems pretty simple to understand, right? Love people. I drove 25 minutes to church today to hear you say love people. Yeah. Sorry. The challenge is, of course, to love people in the same way that Christ has loved us. That's the challenge. This is so hard for us. You want to know why? I think George Bush nailed it when he said that oftentimes we want other people to view us in light of our best intentions, while we view other people in light of their worst actions. We like other people to view us in light of our best intentions. Well, I didn't mean it like that. Come on. You should know me better than that. While we view other people in light of their worst actions. I can't believe you'd say that. After all we've been through. Right? I gotta admit, I've done this. I've done this in my home. I've done this to my wife. I've done this among my coworkers. I've done this with my church family. I've made wrong or incomplete or ignorant assumptions about something that someone said or did. I've created scenarios in my mind countless times, of which I always win those arguments, by the way. And while I feel that in most of those cases, I genuinely think I can stand here before you and say that I have repented and I have done what I need to do to make those right, I am still ashamed with how long that process takes me to show that person the love of Christ. What would it be like if Jesus treated us that way? Holding on to grudges, harboring bitterness for a long time, withholding forgiveness, giving the silent treatment? Because if that's how Jesus treated me, I would be crushed under the weight of that. Well, Christ doesn't love me like that. Do you want to know why? Because love lays down. That's what it does. So I'd like to simply close by asking you to reflect on a couple questions here today. The first one is this. How has Jesus loved you? Be specific. How has Jesus loved you? In order to help you process this, I just want to draw our attention to the greatest way Jesus has loved us, in the way that he laid down his life unto death on the cross for our salvation. Now, if you came here this morning and you did not pick up one of those little communion cups on your way in, I want to encourage you right now. You can go to one of our tables in the back, grab one and return to your seat. The rest of you can go ahead and grab that cup and have that handy here. Now's a good time as we transition into this remembrance. I just want us to remember what Paul wrote in Romans 5:8. Romans 5:8. He wrote this, "But God proves his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." God proves it. It's evidence. So think about it this way. Our obedience is evidence of our love for him. And even God gives evidence to his love for us. He proves it to us. Now, I'm not sure that proves is the best English word in this text to understand that Greek word. Your NIV might say demonstrates. That's not bad. I wonder if maybe another word, English word we could use is that of recommends. God recommends his love to us, but even that seems a little flimsy. I just think that the English language is really struggling to figure out the way to this word, because the context here is so weighty. The context is this. It is while we were still sinners that Christ did that for us. That's the weight of it. Our condition, our position, was that we were still steeped in sin when Christ decided that he was going to love us in the most humbling and sacrificial way. The infinite, eternal love of God was joyfully transferred to us in Christ on the cross. This is what we remember and celebrate each week. And it makes sense. It makes sense for us to remember the Lord's Supper right now. I mean, after all, we've been hearing Jesus' words from that upper room discourse. This would be just moments after he established this memorial for all of those who would follow him. And if trust is a mark of friendship, then we even see this powerful connection out of the lips of our Savior when he's hanging on the cross. Father, into your hands I entrust my spirit to you. I commit myself to you. Obedience, love, relationship, trust, they're all found in Jesus on the cross. So as we receive this bread that represents Christ's body broken for us, and as we receive the juice that refreshes our memory of his infinite love poured out for our cleansing, I pray that we would give thanks for the friendship that he desperately desires to have with you. So what I want to do here is offer a quiet moment for us to dwell on these things and to give him thanks. And then we'll receive the bread and the juice together. Let's do that now as we reflect. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for what you've done for us in the cross. And as we receive this bread and juice as gifts from your hands, we look forward to the day when we'll be with you in the home that you have made for us. So even now, help us to remain with you. And we pray this through Christ. Amen. Church, let's receive this bread and juice as a gift from the Lord right now. Maybe you don't feel like his friend. Maybe you don't even feel like his servant. Maybe here today you feel far from God, like you're an enemy of God, even opposed to him. That's how James would describe it. James chapter 4, verse 4, he says, "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hostility toward God? So whoever wants to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God." Maybe that's how you feel today. I want you to know that the good news of the gospel says that you don't have to stay stuck like that. The good news of the gospel says that you can turn from that. The Bible word we use for that is repent. You can repent from that. This is not just you receiving a great gift. Part of receiving that is that you turn away from the old. The great promise of 2 Corinthians chapter 5 is that we can become a new creation in him. Fresh start. And it begins as we turn away from that. We turn away from the way of hostility against God. We turn toward friendship with God. That can happen today. And I would love to pray with you about that. I would love to talk to you about that, to open the scriptures together. So I'll be in our decision point area in just a moment, and I would love to talk with you about that. But here's the thing, no matter who we are today, no matter who's in the room, I want to provide some space for us to consider this second question. The first one is, how has Jesus loved you? The second question is this, how can you love others like Jesus has loved you? And here's my encouragement to you as you have some space to think about this, is to be specific. Be specific. And I want to encourage you to, first of all, take the time to actually listen for God. The value is that every day we hear from God. The value is that every day we hear from God. Every day we hear from God. Opening His Word, hearing what His Spirit is directing us to do. And then we write it down. We make a note. Maybe the Lord is going to bring someone to mind that you need to visit with this week and say, I'm sorry. I've been withholding forgiveness. Or I'm sorry. I've been holding a grudge. I want to encourage you to get your phone out, make a note, write it down, whatever you got to do, put it in the calendar, put it in a reminder, something that pops up later on and reminds you to do something, to obey. And I just want to provide some space for you to think about that and just ask the Lord that question. How do you want me to love others the way that you have loved me? And then listen and write it down. The band's going to provide some space for that just now. And then they will invite us to stand, and we're going to pray together a prayer of declaration of who we are in God, who Jesus makes us to be, this unrepeatable uniqueness that He gives to us in this friendship relationship. So take some time to think, to pray, to listen, to write, and then we'll declare this prayer together.
God, we want to thank you. We want to thank you for making us your friend. We want to thank you for giving us a command to obey. God, I pray that in that obedience, it would lead to love, that love would lead to relationship. And through that relationship, we get this confidence to trust. Even when circumstances don't seem favorable, I pray that we'd be able to trust, still obey in the way you have asked us to love. For we are who you say we are. We trust in that. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.